It is possible to be given information about a reaction and then asked to determine in which direction is the reaction going to reach equilibrium. So in other words, we can be given concentrations or pressures of substances that aren't necessarily at equilibrium, but aren't necessarily initial, and then asked to determine which way a system has to go to reach equilibrium. In order to answer that question, we set up a quantity known as the reaction quotient. We use the letter Q for it, and we can assign Q the same subscripts as we do with K. So a C subscript indicates that we are measuring concentrations. We could also do a Q sub P if we were measuring pressures of substances. Because we want to compare the value of Q to K to see in which direction a reaction has to go, we would have to have the exact same setup for both. So again, if you remember our generic equation, A and B reacting to form C and D with the lowercase coefficients, our expression for K looks like this, as does our expression for Q. So Q and K have the exact same setup. They're both products over reactants, coefficients are the exponents. And we do that so that we can compare the two quantities and then determine the direction a reaction has to go. Two very key things to recognize here. One is that K is a constant at a given temperature. So K is a set value for a given reaction, and a reaction will keep reacting until it reaches that ratio of products to reactants that gives us K. Q, however, will change as a reaction proceeds. Obviously, once a system reaches equilibrium, then the value of Q becomes K, so Q equals K. As an example, going back to our favorite equilibrium equation here, recognize that at time zero, our Q would be zero. And that's because, again, if we're writing our expression as products over reactants and coefficients are our exponents, at time zero, notice that I have zero molarity of NO2. And so that's why Q starts at a value of zero. However, as the reaction proceeds, the concentration of NO2 will increase. The concentration of N2O4 will decrease, as we see here in these graphs. Right? Products are increasing, reactants are decreasing. And so as the reaction starts, the value of Q will go up. And it will go up until Q reaches the value of K. So again, at this dotted line where our system has set up equilibrium, this is the point where Q will equal K. And so again, we have to compare our values of Q and K to determine in which direction a reaction is going to go. So we have three possibilities of how this can play out. We can calculate that Q will be less than K. So again, using our generic setup, we know that Q is set up as products over reactants. And so if Q is less than K, remember that K is the goal of a reaction. A reaction will keep going until it reaches the ratio of products to reactants that gives us the value of K. And so in this scenario, it means that Q needs to increase in order to become K. Again, in order for Q to increase, that means that our products have to increase. And at the same time that our products are increasing, our reactants are going to decrease. So think about, again, if we view this equation as an example. If I say that my Q is less than K and my Q needs to increase, that means that I need more products to be formed so that I can get the right ratio of products to reactants. In other words, my reaction is going to shift more toward products, forward or to the right, however you want to phrase it, they're all the same. This would have to shift forward to increase Q. And so as this shifts forward, we're going to increase the concentration of NO2 while we decrease the concentration of N2O4. The next scenario, would be if we calculate that Q is greater than K. So again, K is the goal. The reaction is going to keep going until it reaches the ratio of products to reactants that gives us K. In this case, it means that the value of Q needs to decrease. And again, if Q is written as products over reactants, the only way for this net ratio to decrease is for products to decrease at the same time that reactants are increasing. And so again, looking at this equilibrium expression or equation, if I need to decrease Q, I need to decrease my products, increase my reactants, and the only way that can happen is if my reaction goes in the reverse direction, or to the left, or backwards. And of course, the third scenario would be where Q equals K. Under these conditions, the system's already at equilibrium, there's no shift, and the reaction appears to be done. So let's try this with a practice calculation. Here we have our equilibrium equation. We have our equilibrium constant, and we want to know in which direction will the reaction go to reach equilibrium. Realize in general, for a question like this one, it is insufficient to just guess and say left or right or no change. In order to fully answer this, we do need to set up Q. So although it's not specifically asked for in here, we do need to calculate Q so that we can answer this question. Again, Q is going to have the same setup as K. Products over reactants, coefficients are our exponents. We plug in our values that are given. And sometimes you can make an educated guess based on the numbers that are used. So notice here with our K value, this is going to be reactant favored at equilibrium, meaning I would expect to see a lot more N2O4. And notice with the concentrations that are given, I see a lot more product than reactant. So I can guess the direction it would have to go to fix that. However, to confirm that, we're going to calculate and we go to 3 sig figs because of our concentrations, we get a 7.61. And to finish the problem, I like to rewrite my numbers so I can see them all in one place. This isn't necessary, but it helps me summarize and make sure that I'm not missing anything. Here we can see when I write my Q value underneath and my K value underneath, clearly see that Q is larger. And again, that means that Q needs to decrease. The only way for Q to decrease is for this reaction to go in the reverse direction. And so in other words, the concentration of N2O4 will need to increase while the concentration of NO2 decreases. Again, if you're a visual learner, we can graph it for something that looks like this. Again, notice K is a constant, right? The value of K for a given reaction always stays there. But what can change is the value of Q as a reaction proceeds. So if Q is too small, it needs to increase in order to reach the value of K. That happens when the system moves forward. Obviously, if Q equals K, our system's already at equilibrium. And then if our value of Q is too high, that needs to decrease, and the only way that can happen is for the system to move in the reverse direction. We'll be using this concept of Q versus K throughout the semester. And the common question that I always hear is, how do you know which one you're solving for? So I've given two scenarios here, and I want you to take a second, pause the video, and determine which value, which quantity you need to solve for in each one. When you have your answer, unpause the video, come back for our discussion. Okay, so not all questions are hard. Hopefully in number one, you noticed this statement. And even if I didn't make it that obvious, realize that I've given other hints. Notice that I've mentioned the following concentrations are measured at equilibrium, and I've included the equilibrium subscript here. Anytime we know we're working with equilibrium, that means we're working with our equilibrium constant. And so here we are solving for K. In the second scenario, a couple of hints here. One is I've already given you a K value. I can guarantee that if I've given you a K value, I'm not going to ask you to solve for K. The only exception to that would be if I modified the equation like we just discussed, reversing it, adding equations together, anything like that. But here I'm not changing the equation. I've already given you K. Notice I'm asking, with these given concentrations of hydrogen, iodine, and hydrogen iodide, we want to know, is this system at equilibrium? So anytime you're asked, is it at equilibrium or in which direction is it moving? That is your hint. That's one hint that you're calculating Q. The other hint is if you see a K value and measured quantities for substances, then you're calculating Q to see which way it's going. So I will encourage you to actually practice through these, calculate them out, and check your answers. In the slides that you have, the answers are in there for you to check yourself.